Have you ever wondered how games just have such high quality ground and walls? There's always a lot of depth to those. Do these studios 3D modelers place a bunch of little pebbles in the ground and place bricks for each wall? Wouldn't that result in tons of extra polygons? What if I told you these are just totally flat planes, and through a fancy process called parallax mapping, we fake the depth so it just looks like things are sticking up? In this video, you'll learn how to add the same high quality effect to your game in URP. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy. Here to help you. Ooh, me? Yes, you! Make your game dev dream become reality by helping you add these high quality visuals to your game. Now, parallax mapping is just a really fancy way of sampling textures to give the appearance of depth. We are not adding any new vertices or geometry into our game. That doesn't mean it's free, but it does tend to be cheaper than having that many additional polygons in your game. In a previous video, I showed you how to recreate the entire URP lit shader in ShaderGraph. That's important because you do get some parallax mapping baked into that shader. It just tends to not look very good when you need a lot of depth because it uses a simplified model for that height mapping. Today, we're going to take a look at how we can implement the higher quality parallax mapping to get really nice looking deep depths in our planes. And a parallax map or a height map is just a black and white texture where 0 means there's no height and 1 means there is maximum height. If we take a look at the same sample scene, I've just attached a gold brick material to the entire floor plane. This is a pretty good texture to show this because the bricks are elevated and then we want those deep depths between them with like the mortar or whatever they're connected by. And by the way, this full project is available to you on GitHub for free, as with all of my videos. There's a link in the description so you can play around live as you're watching this video. Now, what we see right now is the lower quality or the standard height mapping, parallax mapping that comes on the lit shader, where if we increase the slider for the height, basically past 0.005, it starts to degrade in how good it looks. So in ShaderGraph, that's done by this node, the parallax mapping node. We can replace that with the parallax occlusion mapping, which used to be reserved just for HDRP, but since, I don't know, maybe Unity 2022 or so, it's been available in URP. Now, because this is a higher quality effect, it has a lot more inputs because we need more levers to pull to tweak it for our performance and our visual quality. The amplitude is the depth. So higher values here make it really stand out more. And typically as you increase that, you also need to increase the steps, which the steps are effectively the number of layers or planes that we're using to simulate this depth. So you can think of this effect as rendering a bunch of planes or layers stacked on top of each other to fake that depth. And you can see right here with only 5 steps, you can actually see each one of those planes and it doesn't look very good. So if you can see those, you need to trade off either the depth or increase the number of steps. Now, as you can imagine, as you increase the number of steps, the number of computations and the complexity of that goes up. So there's a larger performance hit for it. Stay tuned to see how we can optimize our performance to make sure we're not totally slamming the video card for pixels that don't matter. As we move down, in most cases, we're gonna use the tiling and offset that come from the texture, not a big surprise there. And for the primitive size, I usually leave 1 and 1, but if you have a different object scale, you may need to tweak this value as well. Now, finally, we come to the LOD and the LOD threshold. These two, as their name suggests, are directly linked to one another. These affect which MIP map we're using to sample the texture on. Using a value of 0 for LOD means that we're sampling the full quality or the highest quality available. And as we go up in higher numbers, we're sampling lower and lower quality parallax map textures. If you've ever used the LOD group before, you know that LOD quality 0 means the highest quality. It's really high poly. And as we back off, we typically replace that high quality, high vertex mesh with lower and lower polygon ones as we move farther away, increasing the LOD number. The same concept is here. LOD at 0 means the highest quality MIP map available, probably the full quality one, unless you've played with your texture settings. And as we go up, we'll hit half, quarter, eighth, 16th resolution. The LOD threshold tells us at which MIP map level we should start fading out this effect. So if we have 5 MIP maps and we set LOD threshold to 3, we'll see the full strength of the effect until we hit MIP map level 3, and then it'll slowly start fading out to make it less dramatic. Now, earlier we said that this can be very computationally expensive, especially as we increase the number of steps to get a really smooth, deep depth on our plane. So how do games manage having all of their floors and walls and all kinds of things with this parallax mapping where we can walk right up to it and it's still just a plane, but appears to have a lot of depth? Surely they're not doing all of these expensive calculations all the time. That would just tank performance, right? That's right, they're not doing it all the time. The magic is actually in this LOD slider. We've been using it as a slider for illustration purposes, but what if we automatically set the LOD value? Remember that what we're doing is calculated per pixel on the screen since we're in the fragment pass of our shader. So what if the farther away from the camera we were, the higher LOD value we set? If you're getting value so far, make sure you've liked and subscribed. It really helps me a ton and it's totally free for you. We can do that just like this with the scene depth using the sampling mode I. I've done a little bit of extra work here to remap the sampling depth from 0 to an arbitrarily chosen 5, because I find that this works pretty well for this particular texture. This shader will allow us to dynamically configure it in the material. So for each different material, we can play around with the values and find what looks best and gives us a good result with our performance. If we set it to, just so we can really see this, from a 0 to 2, we can see as we move the camera in and out, that depth comes in and comes out and is quite obvious, which is good for this video so you can really see how this is working, that as we get closer to stuff, we start using these calculations and it's really obvious to the player that this depth is there. As we start backing off, eventually there's a line where we just can't tell anymore, it doesn't matter, and we don't need to do all these calculations. That's the same concept as our LOD group, where when the player is really close to something, we'll show the really high quality model, and as we get farther and farther out, we start swapping them out with different models with lower and lower polys because the player can't tell the difference anyway. Now, of course, you can play around with these and find what values work best for your particular textures, your objects, and your game. However you want to do it, I hope you see the power of this node and can appreciate that there are optimization options for us to provide high quality visuals and not totally tank our performance. This is a great way to add a lot of high quality visuals without having to add a lot of models and vertices and LOD groups into your game. And I'm really excited that it is available for URP and not just HDRP. Now, if you're looking to get more into shaders and shader graphs, maybe this was a little bit too high level, too fast paced, I've got a structured approach to learning shader graph in my shader graph course. Got a link in the description to that, where you take it step by step through how to use a tool, what's a blackboard, how can we do things like manipulate vertex positions, procedurally make snow and fire, all kinds of stuff in there. That's a great way to show your support for the channel while still getting a lot of value. Other great ways to support the channel are to use the affiliate links down in the description. Those give me a small percentage of the purchase price at no additional charge to you, which is really helpful since you don't have to become a YouTube member or Patreon supporter to get the full free projects for every single video. If you do want to become a YouTube member or a Patreon supporter, that means the world to me. I'm so grateful for every single person who does that. You'll get access to a private members exclusive Discord. You'll get your name up here at the end of every video and your name in every GitHub repository that comes out while you're a supporter. Starting at the awesome tier, you'll also get a shout out like these awesome folks: Ivan, Ifiobolis, Jason Hansen, Sneddon, Trey Briggs, Will B, Mustafa, Nick5454, and Pixel Wizards. There's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support, and I'll see you on the next video.